So I'm really delighted to introduce today's speaker. We have a really special speaker today talking about a just food system. Our speaker is Karen Washington, who is a farmer and a community activist striving to make the New York City a better place to live by working with neighborhood gardens Bronx neighborhoods in particular to turn empty lots into community gardens. Karen's a board member of the New York Botanical Gardens, and she has been president of the New York City Community Gardens Coalition. She was a driving force in numerous organizations and collectives, standing up for garden protection and preservation, for bringing fresh vegetables to the community, and for food justice across the country. She's led workshops on growing food, and in 2010, Karen co-founded Black Urban Growers, or BUGS, to supporting growers in both urban and rural settings. And in 2019, co-founded Black Farmer Fund, aimed at supporting Black-owned farms and businesses with capital and resources across New York State. In 2012, Ebony Magazine voted Karen one of their 100 most influential African Americans in the country. And in 2014, she was the recipient of the James Beard Leadership Award. And in 2020, Essence Magazine named Karen one of their essential heroes. Karen is today the co-owner farmer at Rise and Root Farm in Chester, New York. And as I said, her topic today is moving beyond COVID-19 towards a just food system. Thank you for being with us, Karen. Welcome to our platform.
Thank you so, so much. Thanks everybody for having me. So I guess I'll share my screen and we'll get cracking. So let me put myself down so I can concentrate. So my topic of today is moving beyond COVID. So I just want to start by recognizing the fact that so many things have happened because of COVID. Many of us have lost loved ones or know folks who have lost their lives because of COVID. But first and foremost, I want people to remember that there were people, loved ones behind those numbers and not just to focus on those numbers. And I realized then that, you know, so much has changed and that we're never gonna go back to the way things were. So how can we move forward in a way that is healing, just, and values all living things? So I wanna begin this process by telling you a little bit about myself. So before COVID, I started working on justice issues back in 1988. It started first with land issues in New York City, turning empty lots into community gardens. Back then, can you imagine at one time, New York City had over 15,000 vacant lots, mostly in low-income neighborhoods and neighborhoods of color. Those that had the opportunity to leave, they left, they called it white flight. Those that remain turn these empty lots into community gardens. Look at that, how beautiful. And this was done, folks, with no resources from the city, was done through sweat equity. A lot of the plants and structures were built by people in the community. Then, however, in 1988, 10 years later, then Mayor Giuliani tried in the dawn of night to auction off 100 community gardens. And back then you said, you can't fight City Hall, but then we did. So community gardens got together to protest, to march on City Hall. In the end, we won the battle, but the war continues and we were able to save those 100 community gardens. And it turns out that believing in a cause and standing up for justice is powerful. And that justice should always be for the people and by the people. So fast forward today, the fight for land continues to happen, especially in urban areas where there's a constant struggle between development and housing. But for me, growing food and fighting for land wasn't enough. And I started to look at the social issues that were in my community, social issues around health, housing, economics, and environment. And the way the food system had impacted my community caused me to question the system, to challenge it. Since 1996, the World Food Summit defined food security as existing when all people at all times have access to sufficient, safe, nutritious food to maintain a healthy and active lifestyle. But the question I ask time and time again, in the greatest country in the world where we grow enough food and we waste enough food, that food is not getting down to the people that need it the most. So many of you have said time and time again, wow, that the food system is broken and it needs to be fixed. And at one time, I did agree. I was drinking a Kool-Aid, believing that it needed to be fixed, until I realized that the struggle for good food and clean water brings to the surface the social economic disparities we often see in communities of color. And when we don't talk about these disparities and act on it, it reinforces a food system that is controlled mainly by a handful of people. Food alone has no power, but now has become a commodity and has been used as a tool for people to have power over others. It is estimated that the population by 2050 will increase in size to 9 billion more people. That's 2 billion more people present today. And most of the burden will be in urban areas. Yet much of today's industrialization runs parallel with the advancements of technology and the mass industrial production of food. But in the end, who benefits? For years, we've talked about this country being the land of milk and honey, but has it now become the land of greed and money? This pandemic has exposed some of the weaknesses that we've already know were prevalent in our food system. The fact that we have a handful of companies to control millions and millions of people's food supply, we have to analyze and say, have we gone from diversity to monocropping based on a single commodity crop, such as corn, wheat, soy? How about farm subsidies, which was supposed to help the farmer back in the 1930s, but now has become a cash cow and dumping ground for processed food and fast food entering the food chain with no nutritional value. We've gone from local markets to global markets due to trade agreements, home cooking to fast food eating, from seasonality to growing and eating food and meat all year round, and a food system in low income neighborhoods that's based on subsidies and charity. So can we say we're actually much better off because we have a food system that is less labor intensive, more efficient and specialized, or more mechanized due to technology? If you can remember the American diet was once plant-based, full of fruits and vegetables and grains, and now has become more animal-based. And as a result, our caloric intake has increased from 2,000 calories per capita to over 3,800 calories per capita. And we have a subsidized charity-based food systems byproduct of industrial ag that ends up in poor urban and rural communities. The food is cheap, has no nutritional value, and it doesn't take rocket science, folks, where this food ends up. For years, I have criticized the charity-based food system that was supposed to be used for emergency purposes like it is today, but has become a secondary grocery store. However, in the long run, this type of food system that is now current because of COVID, in the long run, is not sustainable or should be. This is a wake-up call, folks. a call to challenge the food system, especially during COVID. Even our farming habits have changed as a result, becoming more analytical, data-driven, and local. Consumers now want food that is fresh, local, and healthy. Realizing that to fight this deadly disease, we must be healthy and eat healthy. Technology also must do better, and seeing that all aspects of the food chain has equal opportunity in terms of technology and data. But this doesn't happen unless we have resources and training. Another important thing is that in our schools, we must promote STEM. STEM is the future of our children learning about science and technology and engineering and math. That is critical as we move forward. As for farmers and growers, in light of climate change, we must be able to grow better using data and technology so that we grow not more, but more efficiently. We now know who the essential workers are. They're all the workers along the food chain, the growers, the factory workers, the distributors, the retailers, and of course, the grocers. However, our food system cannot focus just on profits, but we must focus on people and the environment. So now, as we think about moving beyond COVID, when it comes to our food system, folks, does it need to be fixed? I say no. It needs to change. And that change comes with power. Power must go back into the hands of the community. For too long, we have been silent and complacent. We have given up our power to the government, to lobbyists, to big businesses. We must shift the power dynamics of our food system that leaves the poor and communities of color powerless and victimized. So, how has the power dynamics of our food system shown up in society? Well, it shows up as hunger if you don't have it. Shows up as poverty if you're too poor to afford it. It shows up as diet-related diseases because the dumping of so many processed food and junk food into our system. It shows up as organic food when we criticize a food and label it as being elitist, or big ag when we have other people controlling our food system. Understanding the power we have in our community means changing the way we view ourselves holistically and not how outsiders say or think who we are or should be. Many times in our community, especially poor communities with limited access and limited resources and capital, we are always looked in terms of needs, deficit, scarcity, and problems. When thinking about who we are, we need to look at ourselves as in terms of assets, capability, resources, solutions, and strength. Asking a community what they need comes from a place of deficit. Ask a community what they want comes from an area of power. We must value the social capital and communal wealth. What does that mean, social capital? It means that every person must have true value in this country. Collectively, we have the power to change, but many times we are pitted against one another based on bias and external factors. For example, even before the pandemic, folks would often call communities with limited access to food or without supermarkets, food deserts. So if you have a chance to say food deserts, say it now and get it out your system, because I don't want to hear that term again, because I don't live in a desert. I reached out to my friends in Chicago and Philly and Baltimore and Oakland and said, we live in a desert. And sometimes people use the term food swamps, and recently I heard food mirage. This is a political brief and construct from outsiders who would have us to believe that we don't have supermarkets or limited access to food. But we do. We have the fast food. We have the junk food. We have the processed food. What we don't have are healthy food options. So instead, I coined the term food apartheid. So a lot of people are saying, what, food apartheid? I wanted to have and use that term because it brings to the forefront the effects of systemic racism, income inequality, and redlining. This food system has been for years based on the haves and have-nots. And until we recognize that a healthy food system and food is a human right, we must continue to have these hard conversations. Another term I hear time and time again is the term food justice. And I've seen it used in people's RFP, in their motivational speeches, in their in terms of what they do in terms of value statements. And I say, if you look at the definition, food justice represents a transformation of the current food system, including but not limited to eliminating disparities and inequities. And if you look at the word transformation, I tell people food justice doesn't exist unless you're actively participating in dismantling the social injustices that you see in the food system. In other words, food justice is not a passive movement, it's an active movement. And so in order for you to be doing the work of food justice, you must be doing the work to bring down the social injustices that you see. So what are some of the social injustices that are out there? Well, persistent race, gender, and class inequalities, the lack of opportunity to be able to be self-sufficient and self-reliant. Again, what does that mean? Again, putting the power back into the people who have for so long been victimized. The loss of land due to theft, racism, displacement, and of course, gentrification. The lack of living wage jobs and generational wealth disparities. The lack of understanding the historical content of trauma when it comes to oppression, the erasure of indigenous and enslaved contribution towards the history of this United States, and the lack of understanding the historic content due to trauma, and the willingness to control and have power over others. For many of us, we had a food and an economic system that has been extractive and exploitative. We see our resources go out of our community. We shop outside our community. We work outside our community. We travel outside our community. So when we talk about correcting this situation, it's through base building and communal wealth. But what does that look like? Well, it aligns with the principles of food sovereignty, which is the right of people and governments to choose the way food is produced and consumed in order to respect the livelihoods, as well as the policy that support this choice. The goal is less dependency on capital-intensive inputs that extract, and greater attention to the social and environmental principles that build communal wealth. In principle, it's about equity in the decision-making process and the distribution of resources when it comes to the common good of all people. Power must be placed back into the hands of people, thus advocating for greater control over food production and consumption by people who have been marginalized by those with power over us. Power, folks. Power has to happen. It has to change, but it's very, very difficult for people with power to give it up. It's like a drug. They have to have it. But as long as we have a food system that embraces a power dynamic society of power over others, it will remain stagnant and resistant to change. From small farmers to growers to food and farm workers, a healthy food system is not just about growing food, but making sure that all parties along the food chain are treated fairly and humanely. Food has become a commodity based on profits and not on people. In order for the food system to change, we must face the fact that it's about giving up or sharing power. A food system that is dominated by white privilege and wealth with a historical frame of power over has to acknowledge that power and then give it up. And I tell people with power, you got three choices. Either you share it, you give it up, or eventually it'll be taken away from you. So what must be done to change the food system? We must first recognize that the true power lies within communities. More than ever, this pandemic has forced us to redefine what community looks like. We now have engaged folks to focus on a food system that supports local businesses, small farmers, farm workers, and locally grown food. We now have people from all walks of life standing on food lines. Businesses, mom and pop businesses, out of business, both feeling the economic crisis that COVID has handed. So, what are some of the things people are doing to bring power back into communities? Many are reclaiming land and developing community gardens and urban farms. They're talking about land reparation for the first time. They're reaching out and turning their front lawns and their backyards into gardens. They're growing food on their terraces and windowsills. They're working on ways that we can have affordable housing by forming community land trusts. And we're starting to have those hard conversations around land reparation and Black farming. They're growing food that is now culturally appropriate. And they're getting seeds and owning seeds and saving seeds and taking away from seed companies who feel it's their God-given right to patent seeds. They're developing educational and agricultural curriculum based on truth and inclusion. They're growing herbs, both culinary and medicinal herbs. They're forming co-ops and coalitions. They're marching in the streets for equity and rights. They're forming investment funds, speaking up and demonstrating against injustice, forming community-based farmers markets and food boxes and food co-ops, forming local economies around wealth building and investment. So what is it that we can do together? Together we can change the food system by speaking up and advocating for supporting the rights of farm workers and restaurant workers and grocery workers, because we now know they are the essential workers. Supporting those working on access to land and affordable housing. Being open to the idea about land reparation for those who have lost their land or had their land stolen. Demand healthy food and clean water for all. Both are human rights. Support the right to save seeds and the right to have all food labeled. Speak up against hazardous working conditions at major food facilities and businesses. Make sure our elected officials are accountable. Break bread or have a meal with someone you don't know. Make sure yourself feel, make sure that you feel uncomfortable to be comfortable. Speak up and speak out against injustice. Strive for a community that cherishes diversity and inclusion as assets, and develop and support youth leadership. A couple of months ago, I was asked a question. How can agriculture continue to focus on healing? And I immediately turned to life after COVID. In essence, this is what I said, and this is what I wrote. To be honest, we can't focus on healing if we don't acknowledge the trauma that has happened to people, animals, and the environment. We have never fully addressed the evils of enslavement and or the eradication of indigenous people. We have kept that part of our history either hidden or intentionally erased as not to face the sins of this country. The fact that we have developed an economic system based on capitalism that has been exploitative and extractive, focusing more on profits than people. We have shied away from having a truthful conversation on how wealth was built in this country, or who has access to land, capital, and resources. We have allowed divisive rhetoric to become the main narrative of this country due to silence and complacency. So for me to answer this question, we have to get back to the true embodiment of agriculture, which is culture. Culture embodies diversity and it embraces our differences. A monolithic approach to growing food does not work from the standpoint of what we grow to who is growing our food. Our food landscape has changed. There are people with power and privilege controlling most of the industrialized food system in America, namely white men. Yet the vast number of people growing food globally are women and people of color. Today, food has become an essential part of our lives. We see how important it is in combating this enemy that doesn't care about wealth, race, ethnicity. What COVID has shown us is that it's an equal opportunity virus, and we can continue to lose thousands and thousands of people if we don't adhere to what is right. This is a defining moment as a nation to examine our food system. As we wait for everybody to be part of the vaccination, we know that eating healthy and being healthy will help combat this virus. In the name of justice, agriculture must be fair and just. Healthy food must be a human right for all, along with water. We must see that this opportunity to have land and grow food is an option for all and not for some. We must acknowledge the practice of indigenous people and not co-opt their practices as new discovery. When we talk about what it means to be inclusive, that means having power in the decision-making process on all aspects of agriculture, from policy, regulation, law, and a seat at the table. And if we don't have a seat at the table, you know what? We're going to make our own table and bring our own seats. COVID, the January 6th resurrection, and the calling out for justice for Black lives has shown us that we have a lot of healing and repair to do. As we look forward to healing, it must begin within the community at the local level. We must start the caring and sharing amongst ourselves. It's not the government. but the people who will make a difference. Finally, let's raise our voices, raise our shovels together. The impact of COVID has magnified the inequities and inequalities that we see around hunger and poverty. This is our time. We cannot go back. We must reach across communities, states, nations. We now have engaged consumers to focus on a food system that supports local farms. There are dots along the way that we must connect. Our food system on one hand is simple, on the other hand, complex. From the person that puts that seed in the ground to the food that is on your plate, together, the food movement is ours to take back. We all must play a role in building a healthy food system that is fair, that is just, that is equitable, and it starts with each and every one of us. So in closing, I leave you with this. To grow your own food gives you power. You know who and why you grew it. You grew it for yourself, for your family, and for your community. Thank you once again for having me. I was glad to be here today.
Thank you, Karen. That was really a wonderful oratory statement about empowerment and empowering our own engagement with our food. We have some time for some questions. If people would like to ask Karen a question about what she spoke of today, put a raise your hand electronically, and that way we'll be able to see you. And I see Howard raised his hand. Howard, did you raise your hand? Unmute yourself.
Oh, now I can. Thank you. Thank you, Karen. That was really a very valuable lesson and history. My question to you is, what things could we do specifically at this point? We send out a calls to action, and you know, you could let me know sometime in the future or now, what things can we do now that are actionable to help you with your cause?
Well, I think I think what's starting to happen is people are starting to see injustices and speaking up. I think for so long, as society as a whole, we have been silent and complacent. We see things happening before our eyes, but yet we don't get involved. We don't take action. You know, we don't reach out to our elected officials and make them accountable. We always seem to be reactive instead of proactive. And one of the challenges I tell people is like, have you gone and visit a community garden? Have you gone and break bread or meal with people that you don't actually know? Are your boards and your staff diverse or inclusive? Those are the things that I tell people, especially in organizations, to look at. You know, does that need to change? So those are some of the things that you can do right now. And again, challenge the food system, read labels, go into a grocery store and ask where the food comes from. You know, how many people have done that? And making sure that they support the local economy and local farms and businesses. Good question.
I remember there were a number of major local supermarkets that were very engaged in supporting local farms, buying locally. But I don't know if that's really so anymore. The chains are so huge and the vegetables are worldwide. Is there really a lost connection between the local farmer and the major retailers?
Oh, without a doubt. I mean, and this is why you're seeing so many small farmers. Small farmers cannot compete with industrial ag. They can't. And so this is why the consumer comes in to demand and support local farmers, especially a farm like myself. rice root farm. And the fact that even looking at the agricultural system here in New York State, I have a problem with that. And I have been really working to bring to the forefront that out of 57,000 farmers in New York State, only 139 are Black. And so even ask yourself, when's the last time you've seen a Black farmer? When's the last time you even seen a Black farmer at a farmer's market? And so how do we talk about equity and inclusion and wealth building when the odds are against Black farmers? So again, moving forward and trying to meet with the governor and people with the power to change things, to let them know that there is an equity in the food system already. And so how are we going to change it to make sure it's more inclusive and more diverse?
I see a question from Monica. Monica, why don't you unmute yourself and pose your question?
Hi, Karen. Thank you so much for rejoining us. This is the third time we get to see you at Ethical Culture. And I see one of my favorite books behind you there, All We Can Save. Important female perspectives on the climate situation we face. So you talked a little bit about the macro solutions and the micro solutions, and the micro solutions are the things that you named that we individually and in our small communities can do right away, whether it's buying organic food, supporting local farmers and so forth. Could you speak a little bit to the policy stuff? There's a big shift happening now. We need both and everything in between to really, right? So we have these immense subsidies that are going to fossil fuels and big agriculture to subsidize not food, but money-making crops, monocrops and so forth. I know Senator Cory Booker has a wonderful farm bill that he's promoting, and Senator Schumer has the Thrive Act. Can you speak a little bit to policies and what we need to see?
Well, I think, again, it goes to people being involved. Again, being active. For me, I know my council person, I know my congressman, I know my senator, I know my assembly person. You know why? Because I feel it's my right to ask for a meeting. I mean, pick up the phone, excuse me. I mean, I like to meet my senator and meet them. And for me, sitting down with all my elected officials to let them know the problems that I'm seeing within my community. And I don't understand why people feel that they don't or can't do that. Again, we have relinquished our power to governments, to lobbyists, to other people to be our sounding block. And that can't happen. I pick up that phone and call them. Can I have a meeting? And it's always, are you bringing other people behind you or with you? No, I want to have a one-on-one. I want to have a one-on-one with you so I can talk to you about what I'm seeing in my community. It's easy, folks. They have a number, they have a scheduler, pick up the phone, call, and have a one-on-one. But silent complacency, no other people are doing it, so why should I? But what I'm finding and what I'm seeing is that we got a hell of a young people. These young people are not going to stand by and see things happen. I was a baby boomer. I grew up in the 60s. I knew the Vietnam War was make love, make war, make love, not war. And we were supposed to change the world. What happened to us? A lot of us went to Wall Street. A lot of us started to say, you know what? I'm comfortable living in my house. I no longer want to demonstrate. Look what has happened. And so this new young generation, because of social media and because it's now a global phenomenon, I have faith in this new youth generation that's going to make people more accountable collectively, instead of people feeling that it's one or two people who are speaking. Right now, in the 60s, we had leaders. We had leaders. We don't have leaders in this movement now. It's a collective movement of groups that are coming together to voice change.
Thank you.
That's right. We have time for one more question. I see Ken Gans has a question. Go ahead, Ken, unmute yourself. You're not there yet.
I think I heard in the Biden infrastructure plan that there is some activity with supporting Black farmers. I think he allotted several billion dollars for that. I think that's a good move, don't you?
Well, yes. So Booker and Warren put forth the Black Farmer Act. I got to see it to believe it. You know what I'm saying? I mean, I got it. You know, talk is cheap for me. Stuff gets stuck. You know, the ideas come and then they get stuck. And there's going to be some resistance behind it. You know what I'm saying? There's going to be resistance, just like there's resistance to this $15 minimum wage, folks. I mean, why is it that people think that by helping people less fortunate, you're taking out of your pocket, whereby when you embrace and help people at the bottom, you get better. It increases your wealth. But in our heads, we always think of other people taking stuff from us instead of helping those at the bottom, enriching those at the bottom, because you enrich those at the bottom, we all profit and we all become wealthy and inclusive. But we have this mentality is that when we help the poor or disenfranchised, somehow it's taking away from what we have. And until we start thinking about helping those in need and understanding that by helping those in need, we help ourselves a better society. And last point I want to make is that for me, when you look around your organizations or your groups, and if you don't see diversity, you got to call it out and you have to make a change. And you have to say, somebody is missing. You can't be in a sea of whiteness and not question the fact that there are people out there missing. Because you can't practice social justice. You can't practice about being inclusive. You can't practice all those things within your group. And you look around and you all look alike. And so I just want to put that out. Challenge yourself to make change. Get out of your comfort zone to make yourself feel uncomfortable for change to happen.
Oh, thank you, Karen. That was really inspiring, bracing, and important for all of us to hear. So we really thank you. And Rise and Root is really our the subject of our collection this week. So all donations made this week in our basket, our virtual basket, will go to the Karen's Rise and Root Farm and the project that she's engaged in. So I encourage everyone to go to the website, ethical.nyc/donate, and put in something for today's basket.
Thank you so much. I appreciate that.
Thank you, Karen. Thank you, Karen.
Yeah.